By the late 14th and early 15th centuries, the Renaissance spirit of rebirth and renewal inspired both scientific inquiry and creative individualism in European civilization. It also influenced how fighting men of the age approached the practice of arms, or the arte palestrina. Within the Renaissance culture of inquiry and exploration that developed, fencing study began to be related to different artistic and scientific disciplines. All the while, it built upon existing military traditions as it changed to meet new self-defense challenges. Early in the 15th century, humanist educators advocated for the aristocracies of northern Italian city-states an upbringing based on study of classical literature combined with vigorous physical training, especially in the art of arms. Intended to instill good moral character and practical judgment rather than specialized professional knowledge, it aimed at preparing young men for a public life of civic service. Renaissance martial arts literature reflects the Western cultural tradition of book learning, the classical humanist view of the value to the fighting man of both arms and letters. The role of the liberal arts as connected to the martial arts became recognized in the 15th and 16th centuries as part of professional military study, even as the craft of fighting itself was understood to be about optimizing movement while avoiding patterns. The authors of the fight books at times also made significant use of symbolism and metaphor to convey the characteristics of a good fighter or proper knight. Following from a Greco-Roman heritage, several fighting books also employed the literary device of dialogue, dialectic conversations between a master and a pupil, wherein the eager young novice student is free, even encouraged, to inquire, doubt, and question, while the experienced teacher answers and explains, clarifying inconsistencies and justifying unique cases. The combat teachings presented within Renaissance martial arts literature is frequently given as simple example counterstrikes or sequences of exchanged action to illustrate general principles, major concepts, or specific techniques. More often, the sources offer simple cases of offensive and defensive fighting actions that can be practiced alone or with a partner. Even today, much the same process of transmission underlines most any serious method of self-defense. The Renaissance masters of the art and science of fencing taught the application of distinct core elements of fighting, including leverage and pressure, blows and counterstrikes, displacements and warding, closing in and withdrawing, seizures, throws, takedowns, disarms, ready postures, and footwork, among other actions. While typically being professional men-at-arms, Renaissance masters were generally soldiers and knights, as well as accomplished men of learning. They were often theologians, mathematicians, scholars, as well as painters, architects, engineers, and even physicians. Geometry, mathematics, and philosophy often played major roles in their teachings. Among their patrons were princes, dukes, barons, and kings, as well as knights and common tradesmen. Yet the masters of defense who prospered in these times did not just teach how to fight, but regularly addressed when and where and under what conditions it was appropriate to use violent force. Frequent reference to what were and were not honorable and just quarrels runs throughout their martial teachings. While invoking a tradition of classical virtues embracing wisdom, strength, prudence, and audacity, They typically taught that the proper use of fighting skills was not in vengeance or anger, but in defense of church, king, country, and oneself. Skill in arms was not performed in a psychological vacuum either, but compelled a mental and emotional discipline of focused resolution. The literature of Renaissance martial arts reveals the warrior spirit of the ideal fighting man, whether as noble knight or later gentleman courtier, was an ethic that combined values from Christian, chivalric, and humanist traditions. Many authors of fighting books directly connected ethical character and personal combat skill within a framework of Christian faith. A spiritual component emphasizing the role of piety is frequently emphasized in their teachings. Given the brutality of the age, it is no surprise moral guidance in the use of violence was often a concern to the Renaissance fighting man. Because weapons and fighting skills are both simply tools, they can be used for good or ill. They do not come with built-in values. How they were used for justice or cruelty depended upon those who wielded them. This was understood by medieval and Renaissance fighting men and is why they attached certain ethics to their study. There are timeless lessons to learn from knights and Renaissance warriors that can well serve us again today, whatever our weapons and our opponents. As part of the long philosophical, moral, and legal traditions of Western civilization, the values and ethics of the Renaissance man-at-arms hold considerable relevance for us still today.